Good morning, Peralta colleagues. My name is Inger Stark, and all of those Flex Day email announcements you got came from me. I'm sorry there were so many, perhaps, but I just wanted to capture everybody's attention. I wanted to launch the day by welcoming you and asking for Dr. Jennifer Shanoski, the Peralta Federation of Teachers Presidents, to do a sort of warm morning welcome, give us a little bit of news. And then I'm going to take just a few minutes to tell you, actually, Jennifer, I think I'll do this first as people are joining us. So one of the things I get a lot of questions about is, what is Flex Day exactly? People are used to it. They see the flyers, the emails, they join professional development activities, but a lot of people don't know that Flex Day is actually a contract that we have with the state chancellor's office. They are essentially part of our 17 and a half week teaching schedule. And what the state allows us to do if we formally submit an application is to take 3 days off the teaching schedule so that faculty can participate in professional development activities. So Peralta is actually paid the same for the flex days as it is as if they were teaching days. We consider these to be, super important. As you know, two of them happen at the beginning of the semester and one at the end. But a lot of people don't realize that they're actually part of a formal contract with the state chancellor's office that we, in the K-12 system, people call them sort of teacher in-service days, where students aren't at school and teachers are doing professional development. So I just wanted to say that, kind of frame what the day today and tomorrow are for faculty who don't know that. And then also let you know that this will probably be my last Flex Day welcome. I'm in my third year as the district professional development coordinator, and I'm gonna step down to make room for some new folks to come in. Logistically, we do this time have the chat set up that so people can dialogue, correct Mark, with each other in the chat. And I will be watching the Q&A, but the chancellor, when it gets to her presentation, will not be. So the Q&A kind of would be a place for you to ask me questions, and I'll do my best to answer them. And then with that, I guess I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Shanoski, to the PFT president, to welcome you to the day.
Thank you so much, Inger. Welcome everybody. Welcome back for the spring 2023 semester. I really want to start by thanking Inger for the time and energy required to make these Flex Days successful and for the years that she has dedicated to this work. So thank you so much. We all appreciate you. Like Inger, this is my last semester appearing before you in this role. This will be my last Flex Day welcome as your PFT president. After three terms, that's 6 years, I've decided to return to teaching my real passion and the reason that I came to Peralta. I think it's important that we make space for new leadership, new ideas, and new energy. I trust that the organizing union that we've all built together will continue to make great strides towards improving faculty working conditions, wages, and benefits, that we'll continue to make strong connections with community groups and other unions in the area, both within Peralta and outside of Peralta, and that we'll continue to work with all faculty to remain the strong, united, and focused union that we've become to serve our students and our communities. I'm really grateful to all faculty who voted for me three times and encouraged me every step along the way. Even when people are complaining, they have done it in a really kind way. And I am grateful, and I hope you'll afford the new PFT president the same. It's been a real privilege and honor to serve you all. And I'm gonna stop now before I cry. PFT has three workshops today. We have a noontime part-time faculty meeting. We have a general membership meeting at 3. I really encourage folks to attend the general membership meeting. We will be giving updates on issues like our healthcare situation, our class cutting campaign, our part-time healthcare negotiations, negotiations in general, spring organizing efforts, our CFT convention, the election for new officers, and much more. So please mark your calendars at 3 o'clock and join us. And then we're gonna have a book club at 4 o'clock. We are going to review, I don't have it here with me, sadly. We're going to review Isserles's The Cost of Completion, which really takes a hard look at the neoliberal approaches towards education, specifically community college education, and the way that we've really tried to frame education as a business and how detrimental it is to the outcomes of our students. So that'll be at 4 o'clock. All PFT meetings will be in person. We'll be at the PFT office, just catty corner from the district office. And we will have Zoom options available, but we really encourage folks to attend. It's much more interesting, exciting, and engaging when you're there in person. And we will be offering refreshments at the book club at 4. So we'll have some beer and wine and soda, and we'll have some appetizers to share at 4 o'clock in true book club fashion. Members are invited to join. And if you're not a member, I encourage you to sign up. I will put the membership form link in the chat so you have the opportunity. Thank you again. And I hope you have a great day today. And I hope to see you later this afternoon.
Thank you, Jennifer. I will definitely be at the book club. Faculty tend to have a propensity to go places where there's food. So I will be there too. I also wanted to invite everybody at the end of the day to join us at Mad Oak downtown. We're gonna have a happy hour. Last Flex Day, I offered to buy anyone who got there before 6 a drink, and it cost me a fortune because everyone showed up on time. So today, you're on your own, buying your own cocktails. You're welcome to buy me one if you'd like. The other thing I wanted to say before I hand it off is that Flex Day works both because the PFT contract ensures a number of faculty release positions, the one that I hold and the one that the PD committees at the colleges hold, and that the PFT contract ensures a set of funds each year for us to run Flex Day. It also works because the district office and administration is very supportive of Flex Day. I wanna thank Mark Johnson, the PIO, and his team. They always do a huge amount to make today successful. And the college Flex Days work because often the administration on the college's campuses provide a lot of assistance and support to make Flex Day work as well. So I wanna thank everybody. And again, thank you for letting me serve in this role. And I look forward to returning to Laney to teach sociology. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Mark Johnson, our PIO, to launch the chancellor's presentation.
Great, thank you, Dr. Stark. Good morning, Peralta community. Also, thank you, Dr. Shanoski. Very sad news. I didn't realize that this was your last term as PFT president. It's been an honor. It is my pleasure to introduce this morning Dr. Jannett N. Jackson, our interim chancellor. She's been at Peralta for a long time over the years, started as a VPI at College of Alameda, served as the president of College of Alameda for many years before moving over to become the chancellor of the Chabot Las Positas District. So a very experienced community college educator, but also a retired colonel in the U.S. Military Army Reserve. So thank you, Dr. Jackson, for your service. And finally, a resident of the Peralta District. So Dr. J has moved to Jack London Square. So wonderful to have you physically here with us. So with that, it is my honor and pleasure to introduce Dr. Jackson. Over to you, Chancellor.
All right. Thank you very much, and welcome everyone. And gosh, where do I begin? I have a lot of slides, but I'm going to go through them quickly because I do want to leave some time for questions and answers. But we have been really busy So I'm going to ask Mark if he will help me through this process. There's one section that I really want him to talk about so you can understand some of the biometrics that we've gotten in and the matrices and the software to do some like an overview. So I'm going to cover all of our major areas, but I want to go back and do a kind of a touchstone of where we were back when I came on board. And if I'm going too fast, Maureen, let me know, and I will try to slow down. I don't want you to be frantic.
No, but no problem. You. No problem.
All right. So when I started in April of 2021, the first presentation that I made during Flex Day, I started with this slide, and I told you about the story of Ubuntu, which is an African tribe, and it's more than just a tribe, but also it is their philosophy of Ubuntu, and it permeates throughout the African diaspora. And basically what it says is, I am because we are. And in this story, I told you about anthropologist who was visiting this tribe, and she wanted to give the kids something when she left. So she gathered all of her candy together and put it in a bag and put it by a tree and drew a line about 100 meters and said, okay, you guys, line up. And then when I say go, run, and whoever is the fastest will get the bag of goodies. And to her surprise, what they did was lock arms and walk together to the tree, sat down in a circle, and then dispersed the candy amongst themselves. And when she asked, but why did you do that? It was because I am because we are. I can't be happy if my friends are not happy. And so I've tried to carry that through my leadership within the district. It hasn't always been easy. We haven't always agreed, but I think we have accomplished some amazing things. And I just want to share some of those things with you. So next slide. This next slide is really a throwback to my time in the military. It was a slogan, yes, we can, because women stepped up during World War II and did a lot of the jobs that men that went off to war did. So we can do it, and we have done it. I want to show you. So next slide, Mark. So 2022, wow, what a year. So I think sometimes we forget to celebrate our successes. We're so busy doing things, we don't sit back and reflect. So that's what this presentation is going to be. And then again, I want to leave time to answer questions. The board passed a new mission. It says we are a collaborative of colleges, advancing social and economic transformation for students and our community through quality education rooted in equity, social justice, environmental sustainability, and partnerships. And if you looked at the old mission, it was probably about 8 paragraphs. And I think it took a bit, but I believe that the board, with the help of Dr. Helen Benjamin, as we went through our retreat, really captured the essence of what our mission is as a collaborative of colleges. So next slide. Technology, wow, this is my area, and this year we have been busy. We have our new modules that were launched for finance and HR. That took place in April of 2022. So now you have employee self-service, you have manager self-service, we have contracts and more. The training is available online. If you go to the top of the screen, when you go to the webpage, the splash page, and you go to faculty and staff and go down to technology, you will see all of the training. You'll see this menu that says PeopleSoft upgrade. So if you forget something or you don't know how to do it, it's all out there online. We contracted with Huron and they did a great job. We're now getting ready to go into phase 3, campus solutions. And that is the student journey. And all of us know the problems that we've had. Some of you have tried to actually you know, enroll through CC, apply and go through our process. It is extremely cumbersome. And so we're starting to do that. We contracted with someone to map out our process. When I got here, I looked at it and it really didn't capture everything. There was very little participation amongst the colleges or the campuses. And it just, it was, we tried to resurrect it, Dr. Stephanie Joker and I, but we just couldn't do it. So we had to bring in someone to redo that. So we've had to kind of restart it, but we are already getting ready to have a report and probably the end of this month, the beginning of March. And Kathy Bader has been working with us on that. She has a lot of background in student services, and she also has a background in Oracle and PeopleSoft. So she's going to be able to marry those two together and guide us so that we do the right thing for our students and get this done, phase three. Next slide. Website launch, wow. When I got here, our website, to say it was dated, I think is an understatement. Now it looks fresh, it looks clean. Erin Harbor, our web content developer, has done an amazing job. And I just want to thank the MCPR for all the work that they've done to make our webpage look more contemporary. It is also, you can use it on multiple platforms. Before, if you tried to call it up on your cell phone, you couldn't get everything. It just didn't look right. So we've done a lot of that. One of the other big things is it has a translation. So it has multiple languages that is provided free. By Google, I believe it is. So we have done a great job on our webpage, and it's ADA compliant also. So it wasn't before where it wasn't tagged. You couldn't put your mouse over and find out if you had a hearing sight impairment. So really great job. Next slide.
Dr. Jackson, could we pause a minute to switch interpreters?
Yes, I will wait.
Okay, one moment.
Okay. Mark, why don't you bring up the next slide, and that way we'll be queued.
I'm just not seeing the spotlight for the second interpreter. Okay. Okay.
Oh, it came and went.
Yes.
Ah, there we are.
Okay.
Is the spotlight on?
I don't see there. Yes.
Okay, Lisa, you're there now. We see you. Hi. Okay, thank you, Maureen.
Okay.
So we were just getting ready to start talking about our financial audits. As you know, we've had a lot of comment. The FITMAT report had 78 points on it, looking at our financial systems, our financial controls or lack thereof. So we've done a lot of work. So for the first time in probably 10 years, we went back 10 years, we had a clean audit. We got an unmodified opinion, which is the highest level of assurance that a CPA firm can provide. That was the first time in 10 years. That is enormous. There were no material weaknesses, whereas previously we did have material weaknesses. And that report went to the board in March of last year. Usually it happens in December, but because of COVID and people coming back, the state chancellor's office extended the deadline and we presented in March on time. So I want to thank Interim Vice Chancellor Adil Ahmed and all of the finance team for their hard work to bring that to fruition. And then guess what? Once you start on the right track, then sometimes it's easier to maintain that. So this year, and this was the audit for 21-22, the same thing. We went out for an RFP. We had a new vendor, and that was, I always forget the acronym. It was not, next slide, 21-22. Oh, go back. I think we're missing a slide. We had a second slide, and it was also, there it is. I don't know what happened to it. We had another clean audit.
Yes, I'm sorry, it just wasn't by CLA.
Okay, it was CDWL.
Yes.
Was the second audit for 21-22. And again, they went through all of our bonds. They went through our Measure A, Measure G, Measure E. They looked at HERF funds, and then they looked at operational funds, general fund. And again, we had another clean audit, unmodified opinion. Next slide. I want to thank Momo did an outstanding job. She is our internal auditor, as well as the rest of the finance team. But she really kind of took the lead on that, her and Marla Williams. Human resources. This one, I am so glad that we moved forward with the transition to CISC. It was a little bit bumpy. But no one will be left behind. That is a commitment that both I and our Vice Chancellor of Human Resources, Ron McKinley, made. We have had a few hiccups, but it's the normal kind of hiccups you have whenever you make a transition. We have had a little over 30 individuals that have been affected. And we are moving forward. So we purchased software. We used to do it by ourselves. And then we moved over to a larger system because there's added value in numbers. And we anticipate about a $5 million savings, and that money has gone directly back into salaries and benefits. And we hope that that will continue so that we can continue to give raises to well-deserving faculty, staff, and administrators. We're one of the lowest within the region in terms of salaries, and I attribute that also to the turnover, because people can get paid doing the same thing in another district and commute, and so we want to be competitive. So we had 10% raises for faculty and staff, and an 8% for administrators. So we're trying to align it with the Bay 10 because this, you know, is a high economic region. And we want to attract and retain the good people that we have. So next slide. I want to thank the benefits team. They did an outstanding job. They were even working during the winter break, trying to make sure that the transition to the new system. So all employees had to update their health insurance. We did have a problem with Kaiser and Anthem, not because of anything with CISC, but because of the technology systems with Kaiser. They do things a little bit different. There wasn't an automatic rollover. And so we have addressed that. That problem came to our attention during the winter break. That's why we had some staff that were working during that time. And then we addressed it right after we got back. We came back in the middle of the week, and by that following Monday, the problem had been addressed, and we were working on making corrections to the system. So if you have a problem, please let us know. And we're doing them one at a time. There right now, like I said, there was about 38 individuals that were affected, not a lot, but still, if you're one of those 38, as I was, it makes a difference to you. Next slide. Our bond program. Oh my God. Next slide. We did the DGS staff, the finance team, legal, the colleges, campus presidents. There were a lot of people involved in this, as well as a team of about 20 outside consultants, because we had to go through the FAA. We had to make sure everything was clean. We had to tighten up some areas. We went to the rating agencies, Moody's and S&P. And so we had to do presentations to them. And for the first time, we got a raise in our ratings. So guess what that meant? That meant that we got a better rate on financing our bonds. And in fact, bonds now, if you look and if you're keeping track of that, if you're an investor or somewhere just like interest rates, above 5%. We got in at 4.74% right before it spiked. It went all the way up to 7%. So we just did an outstanding job, and we got $150 million on the first letting of our second series of our Measure G bonds. And the reason that's important is because we have a lot of upcoming projects. As you can see by the slide, we have the Merritt Child Development Center. We're going to have the groundbreaking ceremony on February the 1st. BCC is moving forward with the Milvia Street project, COA, Automotive Technology. They have a name for it. I don't know what it is. I can't remember, but it is a combination of auto body, auto technology, Toyota 10T, and diesel mechanics. All of those will be combined in a state-of-the-art building. So that's been a long time coming. We were talking about that when I was a vice president at College of Alameda in 2004. So our aviation maintenance, thanks to our federal legislators, we were able to get matching funds so that we could move forward with our aviation maintenance technology program. And then Merritt has its horticulture center that we're moving forward with. And then Laney has its long delayed library and learning resources center. Again, some of those projects we were talking about back in 2004. If you want to know more about the bond, then we have a Bill Peralta webpage so you can keep track of it. And the webpage is also at the bottom to talk about the bond that we just went through. Bond Measure Oversight Committee. We were having problems getting people to sit on this committee. We finally, after a lot of work and some arm twisting on the part of people that I know, we have a active and a bond committee that has a quorum, so they can actually take some action. They presented to the board. They went back and reviewed our spending to make sure. They are a compliance committee made up of volunteers. They get no pay. And they presented to the board showing that we have been spending in compliance. And I really want to thank Andrea Dawson, who's the chair, and also one of those members that I kind of did an arm twist on, Dr. Stacy Thompson, who is the vice chair and is a longtime Peralta employee up at Merritt College in child development. And then she was a dean and then went over to my old district, Sheba Las Vicente, and now is retired. So I'm keeping her busy. Next slide. Governance. We've had a lot of things that have been happening with our board. One of them is we had to go through and redraw our redistricting our boundaries based upon the census. It's something that we do every 10 years. We went through that process, had public comment, and in February of this last year, the board approved the redistricting boundaries, and it is now in place. It is on the webpage, and we also have the link if you're interested in that. Next slide. Board. The board has been very active. They started in 2021, and they have had ongoing retreats. They've had sessions where we focused on certain things like the Enrollment Academy, which was started last year to look at enrollment, and these are their goals. What we've done is we've taken those goals and the colleges have looked at them and said, what are we doing to support those goals? So it's nested is what I call it. And so these are a sample of what the board goals are. We did a great job in meeting the goals. They made some revisions and they're working on finalizing the goals for 23-24. They had their first retreat in January the 10th. And we're moving forward with that. So I want to thank everyone for their assistance in that. We also have two new board members that were elected. We have for Area 7, Sharit Johannes. And we also have, and some of you will remember, Lewis Quindlin, who was with the district for a number of years in the career educational area at Laney College, Area 3 representative. We also elected new board officers. Lewis was elected as the vice president, and Diana Delphine Pope was elected as the president. She was the vice president the previous year. So congratulations to them. Next slide. PCCD prepares people for leadership. I do not believe I would have been a chancellor if I had not started here. You learn, as I say, you cut your teeth on that. And we have two success stories before you. One is the mayor of Oakland, who went to school at Merritt, was a valedictorian, Xing Tao. And we also have Royal Roberts, who has been tapped on the shoulder to go and be the senior assistant to the district attorney, Pamela Price, and he will be leaving on the 24th. That will be his last day. We're looking at having a little reception before the board meeting. We'll get announcements out. So kudos. We also got another board member that was elected. That was Kevin Jenkins. He went to COA and also is an alumni of Laney, went to the Oakland City Council. We are in the process. We just met this week with the subcommittee of the board. We're calling it the screening committee. They come up with a draft, as you can see there. It will be going to the full board on Tuesday of next week, the 24th. And so if you're interested in that, if you know any candidates that might be willing to step in, it will be a provisional appointment, meaning that it will go to the next regularly full election. So it wouldn't be for the full term that Kevin was elected to, but it will give that individual some experience. And maybe they want to go and actually run, maybe they don't. So here is this calendar that's up. Next slide. We're also going out for a chancellor search. The board met with Dr. Benjamin on January the 10th and made the decision that they want to move forward with that. They selected Dr. Miles and also Dr. Benjamin to be the search consultants. And they made some revisions to board policy 2431. We are looking at putting that on the agenda for the PGC that's coming up on the 27th of this month. And we will go through the process of APs, BPs, just like we do for everything else. So this is kind of a tentative schedule. January, February, we'll go through the AP, BP approval process. We'll do advertising in the spring. And then the board will be determining at its upcoming meeting on the 24th, a more detailed timeline of dates. So if you're interested, again, we want to make sure that we have full involvement. This is a huge decision for the district. And I encourage you to be involved. And we're looking at having someone end of year EOY of this year, someone to come in place or earlier, just depending on what we can do. It will require some work and it will require some people making appointments on a timely basis if we're going to keep to that timeline. Next slide. Accreditation. So accreditation, we were looking at the abyss, and you can see by the number of reports we've done over the last few years, that is an incredible amount of work, an incredible amount of work. And that would involve the whole district, faculty, staff, administrators, senior leadership, board members, all of us. And we've done a great job, by the way. So next slide. Even with all of this, we have always been accredited. I want some people to say, well, you know, we were on probation or we are now on warning, but we never lost our accreditation. All the colleges and most of the recommendations were about the district office and the board and finance in particular. So next slide. So these were the six recommendations that we got from our last visit. And there were three observations that came from FITMAT. So we had to address those six. And you'll notice that it jumps from, you know, district recommendation 5 to district recommendation 7 because we already addressed recommendation 6 in the previous report. So, and you will see a theme. you will see under every one of those recommendations, it says the institution has addressed the requirement, corrected the deficiencies, and meets the standard for every one. I took this verbatim from the report that we got from the visiting team. And then the last one under the three fiscal issues, it says the institution has resolved the deficiency identified through fiscal monitoring. So we have done it, folks. We have done it all. And we presented, next slide, to the commission on the 12th of January, which was last week. And I absolutely believe that we will get full accreditation with no sanctions. How can you not when you have met the standard in every area? So the reports are available. You can see the timeline that was there. We got a very promising exit interview followed up by even better report from the team. And then we made our presentation and now we have to wait. The commission met last week and we should get something in writing within 4 to 6 weeks. So hopefully before the end of February. Next slide. Awards and partnerships. I'm not going to cover the colleges. I don't want to steal their thunder because, you know, Flex Day is a college and the district tomorrow. So I'm just going to cover a couple of major things that happen with the district that covers all of the colleges. And that was the PepsiCo partnership. And PepsiCo went out last year and they started on the East Coast and then migrated to the West Coast. But we are only one of two colleges in the state of California that received a $500,000 scholarship. It really is to look at underserved students. And the program looks at scholarships for them. It gives them money. It provides success coaches, financial literacy, and access to emergency grants. So those wraparound services that we never get enough money for. And if we do good, which I think we will, they came out, that's a picture when they brought us the check. And those are students that are standing around us over at the district office. We will be able to get that for 2 years. So tremendous amount. And based upon that funding, we were able to get another grant through an affiliate of Pepsi for another $35,000. So doing really great work on that. Next slide. And then IEPI. When I first started, I had listening sessions. And one of the things, recurring thing that kept coming up, not only if when I met with the classified professionals and the Peralta Classified Senate, but also when I met with administrators, when I met with faculty, and not as much with faculty as it was with the administrative team and with the classified professionals. We don't have a body or institution that looks at professional development for those two groups. We, as Inger just said at the beginning of the hour, there is funding that comes from the state. We're committed to professional development for faculty, but we really don't have that for classified professionals or administrators. So we put in for an IEPI grant. I believe it's $200,000 that we got from them, not $100,000. And with that money, we launched a kind of a collaborative team led by Dr. Siri Brown, also by Maria Spencer, our classified professional at Merritt College. And we are getting ready to launch. I'm not going to talk that much about it because it's a presentation that's going to be made here. And so I don't want to cover that. And it was $200,000. Thank you, Dr. Jones. I was working on this into the wee hours, fine tuning and cleaning. So I apologize for any grammatical errors or any mistakes and hopefully catch them as we go. Next slide. Graduation. Last year, we had a combination. We had online graduations and we had face-to-face graduation. I attended all of those. And I will tell you, if I have a vote, I would say we need to do face-to-face graduations. Just the feeling, the energy, the exuberance of our students, just it's infectious. Merritt had a full graduation. They did students walking across the stage. They had a multi-generational, a multi-year graduation. Anyone from 2020 to 2022 could come and go through the ceremony. It was fantastic. The other colleges, Laney had kind of a gauntlet where students walked through, where faculty and staff, they loved it. They went around, came up, brought their family, took pictures. Again, just the feeling, it reiterates why you went into this profession. Berkeley had a online, and so Alameda had a drive-through, and it was just really, really great. I think, like I said, if I had my vote, it would be that we'd go back to face-to-face graduation. So I think the students enjoyed it. I think the families were able to celebrate in the traditional way and take pictures. And it just the feeling, the spirit, as it were, was there. Okay. Next slide. Enrollment and marketing. I'm going to, if next slide. Okay. We got our, I want to thank MCPR. The staff is gelling over there and they're doing a great job. And so next slide. We got our schedule out. You can see the difference. We're starting to try to brand who we are, still allowing the colleges to have autonomy and putting what they want, but using color coding and a similar kind of overall. So again, thank you, Anne. I saw something that students deserve a face-to-face graduation. I agree with you. So this is our spring campaign. I'm not gonna go into everything, but I just want you to know there's always been the question about what are we doing in terms of marketing? So here are some of the things that we're doing that have been done. We've had videos and banners up with Bay Area News Group. 260,000 postcards went out. I got a postcard. I'm living here. It's kind of like, oh, I got a postcard too, you know? So they are going out, they're looking good. And then Merritt even did something a little bit different. They added some additional funding, next slide. And they actually put up billboards. So spring is free. We are up. I'm gonna give you some numbers in a minute. Here are the web pages. We were very successful. And with fall is free, so we continued it on. Spring is free using our HERF funds. And just want to thank everybody. And I have to say, the idea of fall is free came from Laney College and Dr. Besikoff. And it was adopted. We moved forward full speed ahead, and we haven't looked back. But we've got to do some other things because HERF money is going away at the end of this this term. So next slide. So I'm going to let Mark go through these. These are really to give you a sense of the banners, the things that were on the bus. You can see they're different, but they all have a kind of a branding to them. And I think the last one is the one with Merritt and they're on International Avenue. They put up a big billboard. Right on the way out of Oakland into the next district. So, but great job. Next slide. We also changed our landing page. Like I said, that's the part of, you know, moving forward with the student journey. And we also put up the spring is free. And I wanna share some numbers with you. Next slide, Mark. Like I said, 288,000 households got those postcards. And we see it because the board said, well, how do we know of the efficacy of our marketing efforts? How do we know it's working? So Mark Johnson, who's helping me with this presentation, and also Aaron Harbor, who's our web content developer, did some deep diving. And they found that we had 12,500 hits on our spring is free. So someone had to intentionally go over to that page. It wasn't on the splash page. They had to click and actually go. So 12,500 hits. And I'm going to let you explain this slide, Mark, because I don't want to get it wrong. And then I'll let you go through also the next several slides on media coverage. So if you want to come on, and I'll go to mute.
Great. Thank you, Chancellor, so much. Like the Chancellor said, we created a landing page in HubSpot, which is our content management system. And all of the ads that you saw from the various campaigns that we have running are directing people to visit our landing page so that we can kind of track the efficacy of the ads. And we, as of a few weeks ago, we had over 12,000 page visits to the landing page. So we know that our advertising is reaching people and they are taking action after receiving the ads. So we drilled into the data and we saw that there were over 3,000 students that are new in our PeopleSoft system that were not in the system in 2022 or earlier. So we are reaching new people. We're not claiming credit for all 3,000 of those from our ads, but somehow those people that previously were not students in the fall semester are now students with us in the spring semester. We emailed students, and we know that over 1,000 students who received our enrollment emails to encourage them to enroll, we send to the CCC apply, the people who go through the CCC apply process, but who don't actually complete the enrollment process going through our PeopleSoft campus solution system. And we're able to verify that over 1,000 of those individuals came from a marketing email and completed their enrollment process. The conversions from new leads. So I mentioned just above that we had over 12,000 people visit our landing page. Embedded within the landing page is a form that people can fill out their information, their contact information, and tell us what campus that they're interested in. And we've set up some automation within HubSpot to contact those people. And so we know that our HubSpot automation in collaboration with the campuses has resulted in 277 enrollments. So an opportunity to keep expanding what we do with HubSpot automation tools. We know that the fall is free. Enrollment was up 6% over previous fall semesters, which is great news. Our FTES level is at 11,000. We still have a ways to go in order to get back to where our FTES target. The next section that the Chancellor asked me to talk about was media coverage. So the Fall is Free campaign generated some really great media coverage. And when we offered Spring is Free, we were able to also get really, really great media coverage. The San Francisco Chronicle reported about the Spring is Free. And I think that this article was really significant because this was the first time that San Francisco Chronicle published an article in many years that didn't say the troubled Peralta system. So we, with all of the improvements in our governance and our finances, we really seem to be rounding a corner on that narrative. So with a tool called Meltwater, we're able to monitor the sentiment, how people think about the Peralta brand or the four college brands through the traditional print media combined with our social media, our social platforms like Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and so on. As you can see here, in March of 2022, this is sort of a snapshot of what the normal sentiment had been for Peralta, which was about 15% positive, 3% negative, a little over 80% neutral. And that this the positive versus negative versus neutral is all done algorithmically by Meltwater. In May of 2022, we had 26% positive, 18% negative, and 56% neutral. This was when there was a lot of discussion about class cancellations. And so what we say to the public actually matters as far as a positive opinion, a negative opinion about the district. And as that cancellation narrative kind of died down and the fall is free promotion sped up, you can see in September 22, really amazing numbers, 30% positive social media comments, 70% neutral, and less than 1% negative. So what we say publicly really, really matters and helps the overall community sentiment towards the Peralta District. And this is a quick snapshot of where we are right now. The positive is really great. It's hovering at a really high level, but there is some negative noise out there in the community. And with that, I'll turn it back over to Chancellor Jackson to talk about our return to campus.
Let me unmute myself and let you see my face. I wanted to say on the return to campus, our vaccination policy has not changed. There's been questions just because we're coming back to campus, are we still enforcing it? We are, but we're doing a passive kind of checks. We're not going out like we did before and hiring individuals to go through a screening and checking people's card to make sure. We aren't doing that. The other colleges in the region, the other districts in the region haven't been doing that. Well before we stopped, we were still doing it as late as last semester, but we're not doing that now. Frankly, just the costs were prohibitive and there really wasn't anything to validate that it was being efficacious in terms of, you know, incidents in people coming down with COVID. I can say that we did an extraordinary job with our facilities and cleaning our facilities up. And if you recall, we had an external firm come in to look at our facilities. They found they were woefully neglected. Well before COVID hit, they were woefully neglected. And we have addressed that issue. So we have not had any outbreaks of COVID that have arisen from being on the campus. People have gotten COVID, but it's usually external, and we tell them to stay home. But that is what our policy is. We have a return to campus resolution that is before the board. It will be coming before the board on the 24th. I believe that they are going to endorse that. I did a scan of the other districts within our region. Everybody has been back. Some have been back as late as, you know, 2021 in the fall. So just so you know, that really haven't stopped doing that. Students are still required. We do still have to wear masks again until we can go through the bargaining units and, you know, meet and confer. So next slide. And so if you have any questions, please use Safe Peralta. That is our messaging for getting the word out. We have a Q&A section that we've been building on where every time people ask questions, we update it with, you know, the answer if it's different than what was there before. And so the board will provide some guidance on its meeting coming up on the 24th, but please check that. Another thing in the area of human resources is a telework policy update. And I indicated at a forum, or maybe it was last year, I can't remember, that we were working on a policy, a telework policy. We have a draft of that now. It was presented to the Peralta Classified Senate, PCS, on December the 8th. We are soliciting input from the classified professionals and the vetting is taking place now. We received this tentative schedule that PCS has put forward to us. And they indicated that in December the 15th, they had a meeting and they asked for Senate subcommittee to be formed. The week of December 17th, they convened that subcommittee to kick off a meeting to determine what times they would be looking for in the future. And then during the month of January, where we are now, they're going to be reviewing the draft AP, compare and contrast it with similar policies from other colleges. There are a few colleges that have one, not a lot. We're one of probably the top five in the state that have a policy or working on a policy or have a policy. And we want to ensure that it's in line with state policy and with our SEIU technical agreement. And then in February, the PCS has said that they want to be able to provide recommendations to HR, Vice Chancellor McKinley. They want to schedule a meeting so that we can review the recommendations and then determine the next steps. We have put a lot of work in this, our policy for Alameda County Public Health. I know, Mark. Matt, I agree, but maybe we can address that during questions and answers. Let me get through the rest of this, okay? So telework policy is in the works. It's primarily focused on classified professionals because faculty already have something with the teaching online, et cetera. And administrators will be probably under a similar policy as what we adopt for the classified professionals. Next slide. Campus public safety. Next. Ongoing, Tim Thomas has done a yeoman's job in doing training. Marina Security has gotten training in first aid, and in fact, were instrumental in assisting in an individual who collapsed at Laney College. And because of the training that we had provided, they were able to provide ready assistance. Unfortunately, the individual succumbed, but we were there on the spot with CPR and first aid. These are the areas that we've been working on with Marina Security, increased professionalism, monthly fire inspections, de-escalation training, all of the things that we put in our resolution that we wanted to work on. And I have to remind people, Director Thomas came on board in November of 2021. So hasn't been 2 years yet, a little over a year, and we're still going forward. So please recognize that as we get going. I'm not gonna play this. We do have a 5-step video. I would encourage you to have your students look at it. It's out on the webpage under safety and security. And it's just a reminder, travel with others if you can. You know, we also have an escort service. So if you're here and you don't feel comfortable, you know, call and we'll escort you. Marina Security will escort you to your car. Don't leave things unattended. An administrator went to Starbucks, left his computer on the front seat. I'm only going to Starbucks, pick up my coffee. I already called it in. By the time he walked in, picked up his coffee and walked out, somebody knocked the window out, took his computer and was gone. So please, there's no safe place. It's happening all around. Holistic Safety and Wellness Committee. That committee has met once. We finally have all of the seats filled. So they're going to establish regular meetings for spring 2023, just like our other shared governance. We approved this membership and that had its first meeting, like I said, in the fall. Next meeting. Strategic planning. WestEd, we contracted with WestEd to work with us on our educational master plans and our strategic plans. They will be making a presentation to the board on Tuesday to give an update on that. Each college has its own educational master plan that is particular for that college and that institution. And the district is taking the input from the colleges to develop its strategic plan. That hasn't been the way it's been done in the past. It's usually been the opposite. The district does a strategic plan, then the colleges do their ed master plan. But we felt that it would be appropriate to do it and flip it on its head and actually look and see what the colleges want. We had our first ever charrette For those of you that attended, I hope you got something out of it. I certainly did. We had over 200 people there made up of community members, faculty, staff. There were a few students, not as much as I would like, but we have to engage our students, and we're moving back to that after this post-COVID period. I think we're getting better at that. And these were the four threads that the president's chaired, and then we had a report out. And you can also find this on the webpage. It was videotaped, the beginning, and then also the report outs, if you're interested. Next slide. Our annual report. Again, marketing, communications, and public relations did a tremendous job. If you don't do anything else, click on this and look and see what we did last year. We hadn't done an annual report in a long time. I think it's something that is important. It's a way for us to have a touchstone of, you know, what did we really do? So hopefully this will continue on. It won't just be a one-off. Because I think it's important for us to do that and to share with our constituents and our community what we're doing, how we're doing it, and the successes that we have. We have challenges. Believe me, I know that. I'm dealing with some right now. But I like to look at things as a glass half full rather than half empty. And I think we can do it. So next slide. Ta-da! That's the end of the slideshow. I caught some of the chatter in chat, but I didn't get all of it. So Inger, if you would help me, I'm not sure how we're going to do this, or if you want to ask me questions, or I don't know how.
Let me tell you that the vast majority of questions were about facilities. And okay. I want to answer that by telling folks that I specifically, in response to a lot of the comments in the PD survey we did not ask and even ask Dr. J not to go too deep into facilities. So if that is a disappointment today, that is my fault, not Dr. J's. And that I have captured many of those questions on an email and will forward those to Mark the PD. And also to you, Dr. J, so you can see okay. Kind of the bulk of the questions came in. There were a handful more questions about clarification on safety practices. And what I responded to everybody is that safe.peralta.edu is the primary place where people can get updated information. So most of the questions came into one of those two categories.
Okay. All right. Can I just say one thing about, I know there's been concern about heating and cooling and, you know, all of that in our buildings, on our campuses. There's a history behind it. There's always a story in Peralta. So let me just give you a little bit of the history in Peralta. We identified the problems. We went out to bid. We got a vendor. The vendor has acquired the chillers. I think that's what they're called, but whatever they're called. They've acquired those. And then we went in and put in a request that we had to do because we're making changes, prepping the building, prepping the groundwork, et cetera, et cetera. Had to go through DSA. We found out that the district had not done a report in over 20 years. District hadn't done report. So we had to go and recreate all of those reports. Chillers are still sitting at the vendors, ready to be put on. We can't do anything with it. So we had to do all of that. Then we found that there were some other issues regarding lack of maintenance that had been done on them. And then we also found there may have been actually some tampering that had been done on chillers because when the engineers went out there, they flipped a switch and voila, we got heat. So there's a lot around that I can't go into at this particular meeting. Suffice it to say that we are trying to fix the chillers that we have while we go through DSA to get the approval, because even if we started today, it would be at least 8 to 10 weeks. And that's short. They said it's usually 12 to 16, but they're putting us kind of, you know, because they understand where we are. But I was at the point that I was getting ready to go to to the superintendent, a county superintendent of schools, to ask for, because of safety concerns, so that we could bypass DSA to get this done. However, DSA has been working with us, and we're moving forward, not as fast as I like, absolutely not as fast as I like, but it was because of a history of neglect and malfeasance, I would say, but, you know, I'm using the big word, because to me it was a big issue. So I appreciate, I know nobody likes to be working in a building where it's cold, and I want to thank those of you on the campus that have made adjustments, moved and consolidated, you know, maximize the space in the buildings where there is heat, moving students down to the library in some cases so that, you know, they're not feeling the effects of that. So there's a reason, and we can have a, if you want to let me know feedback, we could have a public forum on safety and a public forum on facilities, because I think those are two of the big items. And then the last thing I'll say is that we're working with a Congresswoman Bonta, Assemblymember Bonta, looking at some funds for us to move forward with implementation. Right now, Director Thomas is a one-man shop, and he is doing tremendous work, but he is one person trying to bring up a system. And even if he was Atlas, you can only hold the world on your shoulders for a certain amount of time, and he's extended that. So I'm looking at bringing in someone to assist him, and so that we can have some continuity and we can have some focus and we can actually build our program, which is what we're trying to do right now. But it takes money to do that. So help us. The committee, the advisory committee, will be a part of that. And we want to hear your voices. So
I think, again, I commit both to the participants today and also to the chancellor and to the PIO that I have captured many of these questions, will frame them, and they can guide what of any other types of events we do going forward. Mark, do you want to say anything in closing?
Yes, I saw in the chat about the confusion about masks and understood. Chancellor or Vice Chancellor McKinley has given me an announcement that will be going out later today, which will confirm that masks are required until we get additional input from the Board of Trustees at their January 24th meeting. We will be updating Safe Peralta right after the announcement goes out. So understood, and thanks for the input there. And yeah, thank you, Inger, for hosting today. I know we had a hard stop at 9:50, and we're now five minutes past
thank
that.
Thank you, Inger.
It's okay. Dr. Jackson, I hope you will join us. The next session is actually incredibly timely. It's about artificial intelligence, particularly the new chatbot, and how those are impacting higher education. Yes. We actually asked John Whitmer to present to us today before this kind of blew up, so it was sort of some good fortune. And so, Dr. J, thank you. I know that you and I are going to be working together to open the PDLC in February, and so that will be coming soon. Anything else you'd like to say in closing?
No, I just want to welcome everybody back. You know, I will never sell Peralta short. We are the comeback story, and we should be proud of that, because trust me, we were at the abyss looking over into years and years and years. If you do your research, you'll find that Compton went on show cause. It took them 15 years, and they don't have four colleges, they have one, and they have an annex. So I think we dodged that bullet. We got through the grand jury, we got through the FITMAT, we've gotten through ACCJC, we've set a trajectory of moving forward, we've got our bond, you know, passed. We have some money coming in for that. We have done so much in such a short period of time. So I want all of you to know it takes all of us. We are interrelated, Ubuntu. I couldn't do it without you. Maybe you couldn't do it without me, but we couldn't do it without each other. So thank you all. I appreciate it. And unfortunately, I have another meeting, but Dr. Droker is going to be there. We kind of split up our, you know, our task today, Inger, but I'll probably be stopped by in some time. And I'm going to be there tonight for
Excellent.
The refreshments.
All right.
Thank you, everyone.
And hopefully most of you can jump right into the next event. We'll probably start just a few minutes late to give the presenter time to get warmed up. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. Have a great semester.